I think I completed two units in the income tax. And the third unit is deductions under section 80. Okay. And income tax is the only one chapter I told already. In your fifth semester, first you studied the basic history. Then after you studied the residential status, then tax-free incomes. After tax-free incomes, you studied income from salary, the first head of income. Then second head of income, income from house property. And the third head of income is income from business or profession. And fourth head of income is income from capital gain. And fifth head is income from other source. Five heads of income you studied already. And thereafter, if there is a loss in any head of income or any source of income, if there is a loss in any source of income or any head of income or any loss brought forward from the previous year, regarding that, how to set off the losses of the current year and how to set off the brought forward losses and how to carry forward the remaining losses to the next year, you studied in the set off and carry forward losses. Okay. After the proper adjustment of losses relating to any source of income, we take the total. We take the total of five heads of income. The five heads of income total is called as gross total income. Okay. So in the gross total income, the income tax department gives certain deductions or the exemption. So whatever gross total income is there, out of that gross total income, if you invested or spend, if you invested your income in a particular areas or you spent your income on a particular areas according to the income tax rules. If you invested your income in the stated heads or in the stated investments, or in the if you spent the amount for a specified purposes, if you spent your income for specified purposes or you spent invested your income in the specified investments, then income tax department gives a deduction to that extent of income, All those deductions are explained under section 80, C280U, under the chapter 4A of the Income Tax Act. There is a section 80C280U, all the section 80, section 80C, sorry, section 80 deals with what are the deductions eligible for the deducting in the total, gross total income. Okay. So all the deductions are explained under section 80 of the income tax in chapter 6A. Remember this. Okay. So first you calculate salary income. Second, you calculate house property income. Third, you calculate business or profession. Next, you calculate capital gain. Thereafter, you calculate other source, and if there are any losses, you set off or carry forward to the next assessment year. After that, you take the total of all the 5 heads of income, whatever total comes, that is the gross total income. In the gross total income, you deduct deductions under section 80C to 80U. Only one section is there, 80, but under that 80 section, there are subsections. There are so many subsections under 80, section 80. All those subsections deals with deductions connected with the gross total income. Okay. So that is explained under chapter 6A of the Income Tax Act. Then they are changing according to the financial bill of the central government. So what are the rules to be followed while computing the gross total income? The tax-free income should not be included. So tax-free incomes are not included. This is already, you know it. Then second is, an assessee can claim certain deductions from the gross total income under section 80C to 80U. 80C to 80U, there are sections. These sections explain the deductions eligible to deduct in the gross total income. Okay. Income Tax Act, in computing the total income of the assessee. But total of all deductions should not exceed the gross total income. Remember this. Your deduction should not be more than the gross total income. If it is more than the gross total income, the gross total income must be maximum limit. Okay. Remember this. Then basic rules regarding deduction under section 80. What are the rules you ought to follow regarding the deduction under section 80? The first rule is, total of all deductions should not exceed gross total income. This is the first point you remember. Whatever total deductions you deduct, you are having permission to deduct, that total should not be more than your gross total income. Then after deducting your deductions, your remaining income should be positive. Your remaining income should be positive or zero. Zero income. And it should not be negative. Remember this point. This is the first rule you have to follow. And second rule is, deduction is allowed if actual amount is paid or deposited or invested. Deduction is allowable only when that is actually spent or actually paid or actually invested. This is the point you remember. No provision is permitted, or provisions are not permitted. You have to complete the transaction. Then third is, deduction is to be claimed by the assessee only. Whatever deduction is there, that deduction is to be claimed by the assessee only, but not other persons. The person who pay the tax, on his income, he is to claim the deduction, but not other persons. Then fourth is, deduction is allowed if the income is computed as per the provisions of income tax rules. Deduction is allowable only when you computed the income as per the provisions of income tax rules. If according to your will and wish you calculated the income, the deduction is not allowed. This is the point. Then next is, return of income is to be filed within the specified time limit. You have to fill the income tax return within the given specified time. Then you are eligible to take the deductions or permit the deductions. Then what are the exemptions regarding this ATC or deductions? The deduction under section ATC to ATU are not allowed from the following income. Whatever deductions you are going to make, all those deductions are made in the gross total income. We deduct in the gross total income, but that deduction should not be made in the following incomes. First is long-term income. Whatever deduction you are going to make, you make in the total gross total income, but don't make in the long-term gain. Remember this. In the long-term gain, there is no deduction. In the short-term gain, there is no deduction. That is nothing but if you are having capital gain, in the capital gain, you are not permitted to take the deductions. For example, you are not having any other heads of income. You are having only capital gain income. You are having the capital gain income only. Then you are not permitted to have the deduction under section ATC to ATU. Remember this. If you are having salary income, house property income, then you are permitted. But only capital gain, not allowed. Okay. Winning from lotteries in the other source head. In the other source head, you are not permitted to deduct the deduction. You are not permitted to deduction whenever your income is winning from lottery, horse race, card game, or in general casual incomes. If you are having casual income, in the casual income, you are not permitted to deduct the deductions under section ATC to ATU. Remember this. Okay. This is the third point. And fourth point is income referred under section 115. That is the share of association of person or body of individuals. Share of association of person or body of individuals. If your income is share of a association of person or body of individuals, then you are not permitted. Your share of income must be income from income received as individual, as HUF or partnership firm. If the income received is income received as association of person or body of individuals, no deduction is allowed. No deduction is allowed. Okay. You remember these four points. Deductions are not allowed. Deductions are not allowed in capital gains, in casual incomes, and income from association of person or body of individuals. This is the point you remember. And next is deduction under section 80C. Deduction under section 80C. This is the first deduction under section 80. Under section 80, the first deduction is 80C. 80C deduction has been introduced in the assessment year 2006 and 7. This deduction introduced in the 6 and 7, assessment year 6 and 7, and thereafter it is continued. Okay, then what are the features of this? It is available to individual and HUF. This deduction is available to individual and HUF. If you are an individual or Hindu undivided family, then this deduction you can claim. You can claim this deduction only when you are an individual or HUF. And second point is, the amount deductible under this section is the actual qualified amount or ₹1,50,000, whichever is less. This amount, this deduction is maximum 1,50,000 under section 80C. you can claim maximum 1,50,000. 1,50,000 or actual qualified amount. Whatever specified amounts are there, that amount or rupees 1,50,000, whichever is less is allowable. This is the second point you remember. And third point is the maximum limit of rupees 1,50,000 to the qualified amount is the aggregate deduction under ATC, ATCCC, ATCCD. Okay. You remember ATC is the first deduction. If you are having only one ATC, 1,50,000 is there. If along with this, ATCCC is there, in that case also 1,50,000. In ATCCD, one, then also 1,50,000. For these three sections, for these three rules, 1,50,000 is limit. For ATC, 1,50,000. ATCCC, 1,50,000. ATCCD, 1,50,000. But the aggregate of these three should not be more than 1,50,000. Suppose you are having ATC, 1,50,000. Then there is no use of ATCCC and ATCCD. Remember this. And if you are having ATCCC, 1,50,000, then there is no use of ATC and ATCCC. Only thing is that the aggregate amount of these three sections should not be more than 1,50,000. Should not be more than 1,50,000. This is the rule. This is the rule. Okay. Then what are the items to be covered in this head? What are the specific investments or specific deposits? What are the items to be covered? I think in this head, 25 to 26 items are there. 25 to 26 items are there. I will explain one by one. The first is life insurance premium. Life insurance premium paid by the assessee on his own life or the life of the family members is eligible deduction. Remember this. Life insurance premium on his own life, life of spouse or children, in case of individual, and in case of HUF, Hindu undivided family, life of members. If insurance premium is paid on the life of members of the HUF, that premium is eligible. Premium is eligible, and qualifying amount is, you see this, actual premium paid or 10% of the sum assured. 10% of the sum assured and 20% of the sum assured if policy is issued before 1/4/2012. You see the complicated term. You see this point very carefully. What is the qualifying amount? Actual premium paid or 10% of the sum assured is eligible. Whichever is less is eligible. But if the policy is taken before 1/4/2012, 20% you have to consider. And 15% of the sum assured, if policy is on the life of person with disability, 15% of the policy value, assured value consider, if the policy is on person with disability means handicap. He may be mentally retarded or physically retarded, physically disabled. Issued on or 1/4/2013. After 1/4/2013, if the policy is issued, and 15% you take. 10% generally, 10% for general SSA, 20% if policy taken before 1/4/2012, and 15% if the policy is taken on the disabled person. Okay, this is the second point. You remember, whichever is less is qualify amount. So you remember, insurance premium is qualify amount. ಎಲ್ಲ ನಿಮಗೆ ಕೇಳುದಿಲ್ಲ, ಸರಿಯಾಗಿ ನೆನ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಹೋಗ್ರಿ. ಇದ್ರ ನೆನ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಇನ್ಶೂರೆನ್ಸ್ ಪ್ರೀಮಿಯಂ ತುಂಬಿದ್ದು ಕ್ವಾಲಿಫೈ ಆಗ್ತತಿ. ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಯಾರ ಮೇಲೆ ಅಂತ ಕೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ, ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಆರ್ ಆನ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಓನ್ ಲೈಫ್. ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ದಿ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್. ಅಂಡ್ ರಿಗಾರ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ದಿಸ್ ನೋಟ್ ಇಸ್ ದೇರ್, ಎನಿ ಪ್ರೀಮಿಯಂ ಪೇಡ್ ಬೈ ಇಂಡಿವಿಜುವಲ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ ಲೈಫ್ ಆಫ್ ಬ್ರದರ್, ಸಿಸ್ಟರ್, ಫಾದರ್, ಮದರ್ ಎಕ್ಸೆಟ್ರಾ ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಕ್ವಾಲಿಫೈ. ಇದೇನು ಬರ್ಸೋ ಅವಶ್ಯಕತೆ ಇಲ್ಲ. ನಾ ಏನ್ ಹೇಳಿದೀನಿ, ಗಂಡ ಹೆಂಡತಿ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ಇದಕ್ಕೊಂದು ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಅಂತ ಕರಿತೀವಿ, ಅವ್ರ ಮೇಲೆ ತಗೋರಿ. ಎಚ್ ಯು ಎಫ್ ಇದ್ರೆ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಮೇಲೆ ತಗೋರಿ. ಆದ್ರೆ ಅದನ್ನ ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಅಣ್ಣ ತಂಗಿ ಅಕ್ಕ ತಂಗಿ ತಮ್ಮನ ಮೇಲೆ ನೀವು ಪಾಲಿಸಿ ತಗೊಂಡ್ರೆ ಅದು ಎಲಿಜಿಬಲ್ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಓಕೆ, ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ದಿ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್. ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಪೇಮೆಂಟ್ ಮೇಡ್ ಟುವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ಡೆಫರ್ಡ್ ಎನಿಟಿ. If you made a payment for the deferred NET plan, if you made the payment for deferred NET plan of LIC or any other approved organization, deferred NET plan, full amount is qualified. Your point sir, NET body payment made towards deferred NET. If annual payment you made to receive the lump sum in future or by way of pension, deferred NET in specified and approved. That is the second point. And third point is deduction made by government. Deduction made by government from salary. Deduction made by the government from salary, qualifying amount for deduction subject to maximum of 1/5 of salary. If the deduction is made by the government from your salary and that deduction is made for the survival of your family members, okay, then that 1/5 of your salary, maximum 1/5 is the qualify amount. Remember this. This is the third point. First point is LIC premium. Second point is payment made towards deferred NET. Third is deduction made by the government from the salary of government employee. ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಪಗಾರದಲ್ಲಿ ಕಟ್ ಮಾಡಿರ್ತದ, ಪಗಾರದಲ್ಲಿ ಕಟ್ ಮಾಡಿರ್ತಂದ್ರ ನಿಮ್ ಪಗಾರದಲ್ಲಿ ಕಟ್ ಹಾಕಿದ್ರಂದ್ರ ಎದುರು ಸಲುವಾಗಿ ಅಂತ ಕೇಳಿ ನಿಮ್ ಮೇಲೆ ಯಾರೇ ದಾವೆ ಹೋಗಿರ್ತಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಕಂಪಲ್ಸರಿ ಡಿಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಇಸ್ ಮೇಡ್, ದೆನ್ 1/5 ಆಫ್ ದಟ್ ಸ್ಯಾಲರಿ ಇಸ್ ಎಲಿಜಿಬಲ್ ಮ್ಯಾಕ್ಸಿಮಮ್. ದೆನ್ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಿಬ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಟುವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಚುಟರಿ ಪ್ರೊವಿಡೆಂಟ್ ಫಂಡ್. Statutory Provident Fund is applicable to central government employees. Okay, so whatever contribution made by the employee to the Statutory Provident Fund, that amount is eligible. This is the fourth point. First point, LIC premium. Second point, deferred NET. Third is deduction by the government from salary. Then fourth is contribution to statutory provident fund by the employee. Okay, full amount is eligible, full amount is qualified. Then fifth point is contribution to public provident fund, PPF. It is applicable for every person. It is applicable for employee as well as non-employee, self-employed persons, businessmen, and every person. Public provident fund contribution minimum 500, there should be minimum 500, maximum 150,000. Maximum 150,000 is eligible. Remember this. Okay. Statutory provident fund, public provident fund. Next is recognized provident fund. Recognized provident fund. Employee contribution to RPF. Employee contribution to recognized provident fund. In your salary chapter, this point is discussed. Whatever contribution made by employer, employer contribution to recognized provident fund, more than 12% is taxable. Okay, more than 12% is taxable. And contribution made to recognized provident fund by the employee, remember this. Contribution to recognized provident fund by the employee is eligible. Employee contribution to RPF. Sorry, I didn't put the word illa but statutory provident fund banto, public provident fund banto, recognized provident fund banto. These are the points. Sixth point. Note, contribution made by employee to unrecognized provident fund is not eligible. Unrecognized provident fund is to go battery. Okay. Then next is seventh point. Contribution to approved superannuation fund. Contribution to approved superannuation fund. Superannuation fund is the fund created for after retirement benefit. This is also after retirement benefit. It is for pleasing the employee after employer retirement. Okay. So, superannuation fund. Approved superannuation. Remember this. Not unapproved. If that fund is approved by the income tax department, that is called as approved superannuation fund. And this amount is fully qualified. And next is subscription to government securities. Subscription to government security. Government securities. If you subscribed or invested in the government security, that is fully exempt. Subscription to government security in specified bonds. Specified bonds, you remember. Government security, yella antalle, kelavondist matra bartavu, otragirbeku. Subscription to National Savings Certificate, NSC, including accrued interest. Remember this. NSC investment, accrued interest means interest redeposited to that account, interest credited to the account. Both are eligible. Interest on NSC and interest, National Savings Certificate. Fully qualified. Investment made to National Savings Certificate and interest credited to your account is fully qualified deduction. Okay. Next, 10 is, number 10 is contribution to Unit Linked Insurance Plan 1971. ULIP, Unit Linked Insurance Plan. Units are sold by the insurance plan, insurance company for mobilization of funds and creating the saving habits, and creating saving habit. So you remember 10th point is unit linked insurance plan. Unit linked insurance plan. Okay. Then 11 is contribution to Unit Trust of India Plan. Unit Trust of India Plans, LIC Mutual Fund are the 11th number. Contribution to Unit Trust of India Plan. Whatever contribution you make to Unit Trust of India Plan, that investment is eligible. And of LIC mutual fund. LIC mutual fund is the L1 point. And next, number 12 is payment towards annuity plan of LIC. Annuity plan is already explained, that is general annuity. This is the specified annuity plan of LIC. Okay. Next is contribution to units of specified mutual fund. Contribution to specified mutual fund, units of specified mutual fund. In your Indian financial service, sorry, Indian financial market, you study the mutual funds. What is mutual fund? What are the futures? What are the benefits? All you study. So, specified mutual fund units or unit trust of India are eligible. Then payment of tuition fee. Payment of tuition fee means it is the tuition fee paid by the assessee on the education of the children. Education of the children. And it is paid to the educational institutions. It is amount paid to educational institution as tuition fee. Tuition fee, remember, in your fee receipt, there are different fees. There are so many fees. Out of all those fees, only tuition fee is eligible. Only tuition fee is eligible. Remember this. Examination fee is there. Tournament fund fee is there. Then PSLL fee is there. NSS fee is there. Then there are examination fee is there. Sports fee is there. Like that, there are so many fees. Out of all those fees, only tuition fee head is eligible. Remember this. 14 point. Tuition fee. You remember this? Fee paid to university, college, school situated in India for the full-time education in case of individual and only for the maximum two children. Only for the maximum two children is qualify amount. Then payment of development fees, donation, corpus fund, development funds, all are not eligible. All are not eligible. Remember this. Then next point is payment of housing loan for construction or purchase of residential house. Repayment of housing loan. Repayment of housing loan. Regarding this point, you studied in your income from house property. In your income from house property, interest on loan paid. Interest on loan is allowable deduction. Interest on loan is covered in your income from house property. Principal amount you have to cover in this point. Principal amount you cover in this point. And interest you cover in the house property head. Remember this. Okay. Repayment of housing loan. Only principal, remember. Principal amount. Then next is subscription to approved sales or debentures. Subscription to approved sales or debenture. Approved sales or debentures. Approved means approved by income tax department. The shares of the central government, debentures of the central government, or any board. If those shares and debentures are approved by the income tax department, then that amount is eligible deduction. Okay. The next is subscription to approved units of mutual fund. Mutual fund already studied. The next is cumulative time deposit. If you deposited cumulative time deposit in 10 or 15 years, not less than 10 years, 10 years or 15 years cumulative deposit scheme, in this scheme, if you deposited in this scheme, that amount is eligible. The 19th point is term deposit with scheduled bank. Term deposit means fixed deposit. Fixed deposit with scheduled bank more than 5 years. More than 5 years is eligible. Less than 5 years is not eligible. Remember this point. 5 years तक का नहीं deposit मार बे को, 5 years के तो हेच्ची deposit मार बे को scheduled bank. Scheduled bank का तो यार वो scheduled bank is not different from nationalized bank. All nationalized banks are scheduled banks, but all scheduled banks are not nationalized banks. Remember this. Okay.